Take charge of the service today, Lord, and have your way, Lord. Let your will be Instead of our own church service, we go together to their church. There's another service where they come to our church, but this is a service we go to their church. But we meet here. We're gonna meet here at 10 o'clock. We're not gonna have Sunday school. We'll be here at 10 o'clock for prayer and just a few words of worship and prayer. And then we're gonna go over to the solemn assembly. Okay, so I ask you not to skip church that day because we're not gonna be together. Because it's embarrassing for a pastor to say, I'm gonna bring my congregation, we're gonna join you. And for everybody to think that means the pastor's going by himself and the rest of the people are staying home. That's not what it means, okay? So let's go over and be a blessing to fellowship with Pastor Sarah. And New Bethel is also another church that we fellowship with. Pastor Alan will probably be there as well, but they're a Saturday worshiping church, and we worship on Sunday, as do Pastor Sample's church. So we will be over in solemn assembly, and that is why we're not having the Lord's Supper today, because we'll have the Lord's Supper during the solemn assembly next week. How do you know that the Word of God instructed His people to call a solemn assembly? He said, call that when your nations are in trouble. There's various times you search the scripture out. It's a commandment of God. It's not just what something we want to do. And solemn means serious. Serious. And we take it seriously. It's called a fast. I want to ask you to ask the Lord what He would have you to do. I know some people are diabetics, but you can fast your phone or your computer or your television or food. You can do a Daniel fast. But I just want to be mindful going into this solemn assembly, but we want to hear from God. And so Thursday and Friday, we're going to set those 2 days aside for fasting. And men of the church, I want to talk to the men and the young men of the church. Friday night, we're going to have a shut-in. We're not going to stay all night. We're going to start with baby steps. We're not going to stay all night, but we're going to come in at 9 p.m. for prayer. And we're going to stay from 9 until midnight. The men, this is a men's shut-in, okay? So I want the men of the church to all make it a priority to be here Friday night at 9 o'clock. If you need a ride, if you don't drive at night, get a hold of Pastor Johnny or myself, and we'll make sure you can make it in and get a ride home. But to spread the word to the men that are not here today, that we're going to have a shut-in Friday night. What we're going to do is we'll pray from 9 to midnight. And then we will break our fast at midnight, okay? So we'll break our fast at midnight, probably go to Denny's and have a bite. That's optional, okay? But we will break our fast. We might have communion here, so I'm still praying about what the Lord would have us to do. So come out Friday night, 9 o'clock, and carpool, call us, let us know, and we'll do that. Now, Saturday morning is a Hanukkah party. What? We're not Jewish. But you know what? We are one family of God. The Word of God says in Ephesians, in the New Testament, that Christ Himself has torn down the middle wall of separation, which once separated us, and then that He has made out of the twain one new man. And you're going to see in the New Testament where Jesus celebrated Hanukkah. And if we ever be like Jesus, we should do what Jesus did, not what Constantine told us to do. We have all these things in the church that come from the Roman Empire and we adopted into our religion. But the truth of the matter is we've abandoned the commandments of God. Now, we're not bound by them, but every single feast and every single one of the celebrations that we find in the Word of God were created for a purpose, and that point us to Jesus Christ. All of the Jewish feasts, they point us to Jesus Christ. The Passover, the Yom Kippur, the Feast of Tabernacles, the Rosh Hashanah, the Pesach, when I first said the Passover, the Sukkot, Purim, they all point us to Jesus Christ, every one. And so you don't find out on Hanukkah, I should have had the Hanukkah out, we have one. I didn't want to confuse you. Well, thank you for the beautiful poinsettias that you brought last week. I had to do my investigation to see the thing. Thank you, Leo. Appreciate those. So we're going to have a Hanukkah party, and we're going to, on Saturday, from 10 until 12, we're going to have jelly donuts and latkes, butter latkes, and potato pancakes, okay? That'll be right here want to talk about Jesus. He is what? The light of the world. Amen? And he said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. And that's what the true meaning of Hanukkah really is about. It's about the light of the world. And it foretells of that it looks at the forerunner to the fulfillment of the prophecy, the abomination of desolation. So you want to understand that from a Christian perspective. And so we're going to have things for the children, if they don't play dreidels and things of that nature. We're going to have stories about Hanukkah, about how God, not the miracle wasn't only that the menorah in the temple burned for 8 days, when he's royal, or they're representing the Holy Spirit. The miracle is that they were able to, a group of priests were able to conquer the mightiest army on earth and regain the temple back in Jerusalem. I mean, people don't talk about that, but it was a group of priests that went up in the mountain to pray, and that's God to give them a sign. And God gave them a sign, and they came down and they took the temple back. It was another mighty thing that God did. So we'll hear about that. Jesus, it says in the Word, it tells us in the New Testament that he was in Jerusalem to celebrate Hanukkah, to celebrate the dedication of the temple. If Jesus did it, if it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. Amen?
Amen.
So that'll be a fun time. It'll be a fun party. That'll be Saturday from 10 to 12. Pastors, I'll set it up. No one has to work, just show up. All right? Well, my household will have to work. The rest of you just show up. Amen? Right here. Another thing I want to tell you about is the church Christmas party. Remember, mark your calendar for the following Saturday, the 19th. I used to have a church open. I used to have an open house in my home, but my home got too crowded to have an open house in it anymore. So I got too much furniture and too many beds door to door. So we're bringing it to the church, and we're going to be having a lasagna, okay? Because everybody gets tired of eating turkey and ham during the holidays. So we're going to be having lasagna and garlic bread, and we'll be having them here. I might tap a couple of you on the shoulder to bake a couple of them. I'll provide the lasagnas, and bake them, bring them here. We'll have a little warm heaven. So that is going to be Saturday the 19th. If you would like to do a cookie exchange, not mandatory, but if you'd like to make holiday cookies, fudge, any of that type of thing, bring the dessert, and we'll share that together. Amen?
Right.
Amen. And that's kind of my gift to the congregation. And then we'll change the calendar on that day. The women's fellowship breakfast has been canceled for this month because we have the Christmas party. They just wanted less Saturdays in the month to do everything. So come out, ladies, and prepare to make merry. Also, at the Christmas party, Mother Watts is asking that we would bring, if you haven't already, that you would bring your family's bag. If you have adopted a family, you bring the children's presents wrapped with their name on it to the party on the very latest. On that day, we're going to have it set up for the Christmas party the following day. Okay? And speaking of which, I haven't figured out the day of it yet, but be listening. I'm going to need cast members for our Christmas play. We're just going to do a one-time little run-through, kind of like we did last year. It'll be really simple. And Samoan, I want at least two dances for you guys. Great, all right? I'll tell you the one you do want to, Ava Maria, if you want to do that one, that would be awesome. And then we have that one of that song, say, Come to the House of God. Okay, so those two, if you have another one or any specials, let me know. We'll write you in the bike, all right? I'll get with you on that. And we had so much going on that we haven't had time to get everything tagged up, but it's going to be a fun time. And then South Sunday, that 20th, is when we will have our Christmas program, and it'll just be a short program, some carols, a little story, a couple of dances, and then we're going to give out the gifts to the people. How many children do you have left, Mother? What?
33.
So I thought there were 25, so I thought we had 8 taken care of, but we have 33, and turning 25. There are still 33 children on the adopted family list, so pray that that we can meet that need. If we can't, we can't. But we have done incredible so far, because we had 96 children, was it? Sorry. Yes.
Actually, it is down to 20.
It is down to 20?
25 or 28, somewhere in there.
Okay, thank you.
My brother here donated $40 to Sister Watts to buy toys and stuff for those kids.
Oh, great.
Thank you so much. Buy warm hats for them.
Praise God. And then the other thing, and Sister Marcy is here, so I don't know what day, but man, we have coats that you want to donate. We took up some collection. There's a men's home or recovery home that we are doing coats for, even though they'll be secondhand coats. So if you have coats you're not wearing or not wearing, bring them in. We'll get them over to that home. Also, we took up a collection of $72 at the men's breakfast yesterday to buy like deodorant, shampoo, toothpaste, whatever things, and we're gonna fill stockings and get those ready for those men as well. So just want you to know some of the things that we are giving. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, I didn't get through those as quickly as I wanted to, so, but now this is the thing I was the most excited about.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Let's look at this little clip up here. All right, so this was yesterday. My godson Caleb was just itching to get baptized. I don't want to wait for the church. Let's go out and do it. So, he made a pronouncement of faith, and this is his baptism right here. We're going to share with the church. See my Hawaii shirt? Amen. So, and we were brave, weren't we? It was very cold. It was very cold. So, we rejoiced with you, Taylor, as being repent, be baptized. Amen. You know, the Word of God says, and you know, I'm excited for your walk. And anyone else want to be baptized? Just let me know. If you want to do it, you don't wait till baptism service. We'll take you out to the cold. Yes, Sister Mitchell.
I have something to share. The Lord really blessed me, you know, I've been, well, the more I help, the more He gives me. I don't know how to tell you, but I was doing for my kids, and somebody came and bought $75 worth of my plants, and so that took care of everything. So the Lord will bless you back if you do give, and the more you give, the more you'll give back.
Yes, He will. Yeah.
You know, I mean, we're just, right now, we're just a smaller congregation, but you know what? I have to say, as your pastor, I'm very proud of what God's been doing in and through you.
Yes,
and
amen.
You've opened up your hearts and your pocketbooks,
amen.
And you've really been given to the work of the Lord. And so, know God is pleased, and He's going to take what we've invested and multiply it. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, let's worship the Lord. Let's have a parsha. So Pastor Fonda, bring the parsha, and then we'll go to worship. Welcome, praise Pastor Fonda.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Good morning.
Miketz, from the end. Week of December 6th to December 12th, 2015.
Pastor Fonda, do you want to tell them in the bulletins instead of on the back now?
Oh, yes. In the bulletins this morning, that little sheet that says portions on it. This is the schedule for the
four readings,
so that you can follow it and do the weekly thing for the whole year. So it's a starting.
I can't see. Does it start this coming month or does it start in?
We already started. We started a bare sheet in October.
Oh, in October it started. So, and it will probably go through October. So. Praise God.
Which one is this now?
This is the December the 6th to December the 12th.
Okay, yeah, see? Yeah, we always do a preview of the one you're supposed to read the following Saturday.
Oh, okay. So this one is from the end. The Torah. portion is Genesis 41, 1 to 4, Genesis 44, 17. And the prophets, Zechariah 2, 14 to Zechariah 4, 7. The gospel is Luke 4, 16 through 31. This too is for the good. The thought for the week. Accept the things that happen to you as good, knowing that apart from God, nothing comes to pass. The Doctrine 3:10. We know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. Romans 8:28. The commentary. The life of Joseph demonstrates God's sovereign hand in human lives. Though the world seems to follow a completely random course around us, God is actually working out His purposes in the midst of it. From Joseph's point of view, there was no reason to suspect that God had His best interests in mind. Joseph had been kidnapped and betrayed by his own brothers, sold into Egypt as a slave, falsely accused of attempted adultery, and imprisoned in a dungeon. His life seemed to be following Murphy's Law. If anything can go wrong, it will. So far, everything had gone wrong. Joseph stubbornly clung to an unshakable confidence in the God of his fathers. Even though everything had tumbled down around him, he kept looking to God and believing that God was working through the chaos. He never fell into depression or dependency because he always believed that he was right where God had placed him. This can be compared to the story of a rabbi from the days of the apostles named Nahum. Everyone called him Nahum, this too, because no matter what happened, he would always say, "This too is for the good." Amazingly, God honored his faith by continually providing miracles for Nahum. Once it happened that Nahum, this too was serving as an ambassador to Rome. He was presented the Roman emperor with a gift from the people of Judea in an attempt to bribe him into reversing some anti-Jewish legal legislation. While en route to Rome, the chest he stopped at an inn. While he slept, the innkeeper stole the precious treasures meant for the emperor from Nahum's chest and replaced them with sand. Nahum went to Rome unaware that he was carrying a box of sand. When the emperor opened the chest and saw the sand, he ordered Nahum to be put to death. Nahum simply replied, "This too is for the good." Just then, Elijah the prophet appeared in the guise of a Roman officer and suggested that perhaps the sand was magic sand. The emperor agreed to test the theory, and indeed, when his troops hurled the sand at their enemies, they prevailed in battle. The emperor immediately released Nahum, reversed his decree against the Jews, and rewarded Nahum with great wealth. The story of Nahum, this too is a good illustration of Joseph's story. Like Nahum, this too, Joseph refused to be pushed around by life's circumstances. Instead, he looked for God for strength and for encouragement, and he kept on believing. In this week's Torah reading, we will see how Joseph's "this too is for the good" type of faith is rewarded and how his fortunes changed.
Amen.
Character and deeds. Giving in secret.
Thank you. Thank you.
If you have a need, you can come and receive prayer. For the breathing problems, I wanna testify because the Lord has to make known his deeds among the nations, among the people. I wanna testify to Pastor Fonda. When she was a child, they said her lungs were full of holes, and she would not live past the age of 12, maybe 16. But when she got filled with the Holy Ghost, and she got totally committed to the Lord, he touched her body. Now when she went back to the doctor, there was no evidence of that, holes in her lungs. There was no evidence of any scar tissue. No evidence of anything. God gave her brand new lungs. And he did it for my mother. He can do it for Dolores. And he did it for my mother. He can do it for Joe. I want you to stand and be in faith, believe that God is going to bring healing to these bodies right now. Oh, the sickness that walks out of the same. I believe we can have the anointing and the power of the Holy Ghost upon us so strong that every person that comes into the presence of God can be healed. I believe we can experience that today. I believe we can. I believe we will. I believe we shall. We shall see a mighty move of God in Jesus' name right here in this place. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. You know, we need to pray the perfect prayer.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Let's pray the perfect prayer. Let's pray in the Spirit. And those that don't pray in the Spirit, pray with the understanding that God will intercede on our behalf for this congregation, that we shall see the miracle signs and wonders promised to the last day church. This is our prayer language. It doesn't need interpretation. The Spirit knows what we're saying to God. Hallelujah. We want more power, Lord, not less. We want more of your Spirit, God, not less. We want everything you have for us, Lord, not just a portion. Hallelujah. 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 Those that wait upon the Lord, he shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as he goes.
Praise. And if you feel like interrupting me, you go right ahead.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Sister Clucky, God confirmed what you said. You know, we're going to be a lighthouse. If we aren't already, as people drive by, thank you, Lord, right now, in Jesus' name, amen.
Great. Your turn.
Brother Watts is quite a guy. He's a blessing to me too.
Yes.
He never lets me get by with anything. The title of this song is Oh What a Day. Thank you.
Boy, that was gorgeous. That horn was awesome. My voice wasn't too shabby either. Wow. The word that says to, it's kind of more bass in this. Can you turn the bass up on there?
There we go. Laugh at your own jokes, right? Praise God. The word God says to praise Him on the high sounding cymbal, and trumpet, and the horn. And wow, what a great, great sounding horn, Brother Ray. God bless me.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. That was so good. Right now, you know, I'm not one of those people that tell you to turn your phone off in church, because I constantly get text messages and prayer requests from people at home that are members, and I'm texting sometimes our sound booth or our media guy. In fact, we're probably going to have a program called Texting in Church for You Texters, where the things that are on the overheads, you can have on your phones as well. So, you know. We're going to get with the 21st century here, but it's not all about that. It's about the ability to communicate, not to be irreverent. I'm not talking about sending and texting and not paying attention to the message. But I'm talking about Sister Marcy. Her leg, she's been having trouble. She's had an infection in her leg, and it swelled up really big, and she asked that the church would pray for her. So. Let's let Marcy in prayer before we go on. Father, we just thank you right now, Lord. Thank you that you are a miracle working God. You are able to do exceedingly above all we can ask, think, or imagine. We ask right now that you would touch every part of that leg, Lord, every problem that's causing this swelling and this infection, whatever it might be. And we command it to come under your control right now in Jesus' name. We claim healing for our sister in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God is working.
Yes, He is.
God is on the move.
Yes.
God is not dead.
Yes.
God is alive and well.
Yes, He is.
God is accomplishing His purpose in our lives.
Yes.
In our lives, plural. God is a wonderful, matchless, creative God who has good things for you and not bad. Amen.
Yeah.
In Jeremiah 29:11, He says, I know the plans I have for you, plans for good and not for evil, to give you a hope and a future or a desired end. God says in His word that my ways are higher than your ways, as high as the heaven is above the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways. God says there is a way that seems right unto man, and the end thereof is death. Amen. God says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. God says, only Jesus comes in the fullness of the volume of the book and knows the end from the beginning. God says, I am the light of the world, and if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Hallelujah. We serve a matchless, mighty God. Let us now pray and ask for His anointing to be upon me as I bring His word unto you this day. Dear Heavenly Father, we come unto you right now. We ask you to give me your grace and your mercy, Lord. Let me decrease as you increase, Lord. Let me be washed in the blood of Jesus and stand blameless before you and your people. Oh God, cleanse me afresh, Lord, if there would be anything in my life that would not be pleasing to you, whether known or unknown, Lord. I put it under the blood of Jesus. I thank you now, Lord, that I am your vessel. I've been cleansed by your blood. I've been empowered by your Holy Spirit. And I have a word for the people of God today from the throne room of the Almighty God in heaven above, who was and is and is to come, and who is in all things and through all things and causes all things to be. I give you all the praise. I give you all the glory. I say increase as I decrease. I say all solely Deo Gloria. To God alone be the glory. And we will give you praise, and we will hear your name proclaimed among the nations, and all God's people said in Jesus' name, amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let us go to Romans, the first chapter. Paul says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated under the gospel of God, which he had promised before by his prophets in the Holy Scripture, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to faith among the nations for his name, among whom are ye also called of Jesus Christ. Looking at this first portion of Romans chapter 1, scriptures 1 through 6, we notice a couple of things. We notice that we must know who we are. Paul knew who he was. He was a servant of Jesus Christ. Are you a servant of Jesus Christ? Have you got the concept that your life is not your own? Do you understand that you've been bought with a mighty precious price? The blood of the Lamb, the blood of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Creator of the world. He gave himself. He came. He grew up among us. He was Emmanuel, God with us. And he came in the form of a man, and he lived the perfect life before us. And then God, the Creator of the entire universe, including you, including me, including your children and your grandchildren and your mama and your papa and your grandma and your grandpa, that very same God that made everything, he walked down the Via Della Rosa. He let men spit upon him and get his beard out. He let them help me without saying a word. He went as a lamb to the slaughter, and he laid down his life because he says, no man takes it from me. I lay it down because he knew who he was. He knew who he was. He is the Lamb of God who gave himself for the foundation of the world, for the remission of our sins. Amen. Can I get a witness? Do you know who you are? Do you know who your Savior is? Do you know what he did for you? Do you understand that this was God Almighty? That God had created everything? That he loved you so much that he came and he was mocked by a wicked and sinful generation, and we're no better today than they were back then. You say, oh, I wouldn't have done it. Oh, yes, you would have. Because mankind, in the heart of man, is desperately wicked, and who can know it? The whole head is sick, and we needed the redemption of the Savior and the blood of Jesus to make us whole again. Do you know who you are?
Hallelujah.
Are you a servant of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Tell that baby I didn't mean to scare him.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to have that baby be baby Jesus. Paul knew his purpose.
Amen. Yes, he did.
He was called to be an apostle.
Yeah.
What is an apostle? An apostle is a preacher and a teacher of the Word of God, no doubt.
Amen.
An apostle is a man or a woman that can rightly divide the Word of truth. Amen.
Yeah.
An apostle is a servant of the Most High God who is led by the Spirit of the Most High God. He is not turned to the left, nor is he turned to the right. He doesn't let his circumstances dissuade him in his mission.
Amen. Praise God.
Paul, this very same Paul, said he learned how to abound, how to have much, how to have great wealth. And he learned how to abase, how to have nothing.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
But whichever state he would find himself in, there with to be content, because he recognized that this was the will of God in Christ Jesus for him.
Hallelujah.
Do you know your purpose? Do you know your calling?
Bible.
Paul knew his place.
he was separated unto the gospel of God.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
What does that mean, separated unto the gospel of God?
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Think about it for a moment. He meant that no matter what the world was doing, he was serving God.
Yeah, amen.
Yeah. You don't know how hard it is. Everybody smokes it. Everybody does it. Yes, I know how hard it is. I am a man, and I have fallen many times in my life. Before the cross of Calvary, and after the cross of Calvary. But I hear him say today that I know that I need the blood of Jesus to cleanse me. It doesn't matter if it's the first day of my walk in salvation, or if it's the last day before I go home to glory, I am going to need to call on the blood of Jesus to cleanse me from my sins. Amen?
Hallelujah.
Because we are not capable of being perfect. But we can walk in holiness, empowered by the Holy Spirit. And that is what we are called to do. Paul knew the scripture, which he had promised before by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. He recognized who Jesus was as the Messiah. After his experience on the road to Damascus, he searched out the scripture. He found it to be true. This same Jesus that he was persecuting to be the Son of God, the Anointed One, the Lamb of God that was foretold that would take away the sins of the world.
Amen.
He knew this and bore witness to it through his spirit, through the scripture, the word of God. You need to study the scripture. You need to study the word of God. It's important.
Hallelujah.
I was talking to one of my sons this week. I said, you can't take out what you don't put in. You see, a computer is just a replica, a simplified replica of our brain. And it's just like that computer. When you get it, it doesn't have any programs on the hard drive. You got to program it in.
Amen.
You got to set the patterns.
Yeah.
Once the patterns are set, then it can pull up the information.
All right.
But you still got to put the information in before the information can be pulled out.
Yeah.
So you got to set up the pattern. The pattern is reading your Bible. The pattern is praying. The pattern is spending time alone with Jesus. The pattern is doing what the being obedient to the word. The pattern is accountability to your pastor, accountability to your brother, to your sister, accountability to your mother, to your father, accountability to your those in the faith that are with you.
Amen.
Accountability is becoming an evil word. Everybody wants to do their own thing these days. But I'm here to tell you that our God is not a God of doing your own thing.
Hallelujah.
We don't say, live and let live, like the old 60s way. Oh, everybody's doing their thing. Let them do their thing. We'll do our thing. Everybody will get to heaven. No.
Man.
It doesn't work that way.
Man,
I was happy to hear Craig Raven say that when we were at the prayer vigil for the young man that got shot in our community. And he would say, live and let live. And he said, but not like the old live and let live.
Amen.
We want our young people to live to be examples of righteousness.
Amen.
And let others live to do the same.
Yes.
Righteousness, peace, joy. Those are the fruits of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Hallelujah. He knew the word. Since he knew the word, he was able to recognize and prove who Jesus was by the scripture.
Yes, Lord.
Can you prove who Jesus is by the scripture? You got to start somewhere. So start that pattern. Start the pattern. What is the pattern? It's like the software program, okay? They use computers. Understand, you got to have software running. Unless you know programming, unless you need DOS, you want to keep it simple. You got to have a program. When you click on it, it opens up.
Yeah.
It's a pattern. It's running in the background, pattern.
Praise God.
And then when the pattern's running day in and day out, you're able to go in there and get specific information and manipulate it around. Whatever information you put in, you can take out.
Praise God.
You can print out a document. You can print out a letter. You can merge the information. You can do all kinds of nifty things with that information. But you got to have the pattern first.
Amen.
The pattern is repentance. Amen?
Amen.
Renewal.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
Revival. Amen?
Yeah.
Reading the word daily.
Praise God.
Spending time in His presence daily.
Yes.
Coming together in fellowship regularly.
Amen.
It's a pattern.
Yeah.
You put the pattern into effect, and then you start putting the individual information in. This is the life application I'm giving it to you in the middle instead of at the end of the sermon, all right?
All right.
The life application is you take the pattern, you determine, I'm going to be obedient. I'm going to be obedient. I'm going to sacrifice my will. I'm going to sacrifice my desire. And I'm going to create a pattern, a regular pattern, when I spend time with God. I'm going to come up with a pattern where I put in, when I put in the information, when I put in the prayer, where I listen.
Yes,
so His Holy Spirit can put it into me.
Praise the Lord.
You decide in advance you're going to give God the pattern.
Praise
but
God.
Then you let His Holy Spirit come up with the process.
Praise the Lord.
You see, you can do the pattern, but only He can do the process.
Amen.
I was talking to somebody that didn't like that movie, The War Room, because there wasn't enough strategy yet. And I said, no, but they had the pattern. The pattern was to go regularly into the prayer room.
Amen.
That was the pattern.
Amen.
The process, the strategy is God's and God's alone.
Yeah.
You see, things of the supernatural are real. And God is master of it all. And when you're doing things God's way, it's a constant surrendering. It's obedience in the, to the power.
Yes, yes.
Obedience to the power.
Yes, yes.
Surrendering of the will.
Hallelujah.
But then He works out the strategy. God gives a strategy through His Holy Spirit. Sometimes He reveals it to you. Sometimes He does not. But it's that's the strategies are good. Nothing wrong with God's strategy. But we have to have His Holy Spirit bring that strategy. And we don't get that strategy from God if we don't spend regular time in the pattern.
All right.
We got to have that regular time to be devoted to God. And then we have to be obedient when we read in this word to do it.
Yes.
What does the word say? Be ye doers of the word, not hearers only. Amen?
Amen.
So we got to study the word, but that's not all we have to do. We still have to take care of our responsibilities, but we have to see the Holy Spirit allow us to do that. And we have to ask Him, how do we do that? Where do we go from there? What's the next step, you know?
Yeah.
But a lot of men, they get too, women too, probably, but I can speak for our children, a lot of times we get too caught up in the process.
All right.
We need to provide for our families, so we go to work.
All right.
We're going to work, not necessarily, not everybody's a pastor, not necessarily in the church. I go to work in a real estate office. I go to work in my car. Whatever it takes, I go to work.
Praise God, praise God.
But if I'm not careful, I can think that it's my work that brings my provision, where it's the other way around. I've got to spend the right amount of time with God to have the provision. I mean, like, for instance, I'll give you a practice. Application of my own life. Last night, when I got done with all my activities and got my daughter home from her play, it was well close to 11 o'clock. Just the right time to go out and make some money if I'm going to drive, you know, drive, give people rides. But I had to pray about it. And the Holy Spirit said, no, you need to rest. You need to spend time in my presence. You need to come into my presence, so I can give you the word for the people tomorrow. I started putting it in your heart, but you haven't finalized it. You need to get it done. You need to stay in my presence, also by the need.
Praise the Lord.
You see, people don't understand that we want to do something. I'm not a lazy man. I'll work. I said to someone, I'm just giving up my sleep. But I have to listen to the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Because I'm going to be good to nobody from 6 feet under.
Amen.
I'm going to be no good to you if I don't bring you the word God has for you.
All right.
And I'm not going to bring that word if I don't spend time in my word.
Amen.
And time in my prayer.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Paul knew who Jesus was, is his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection of the dead.
Yeah.
Do you know who you are? Do you know your place? Well, Paul knew who you are. Look, by whom we have received grace and apostleship. Okay, let's stop there. We. That's everybody, right?
Yes.
The body of Christ. Yes. By whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among the nation, among all nations, for his name, among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
That's who you are. You are the called of Jesus Christ.
Yes. Yes.
He gave his life for you. You accepted him as your Lord and Savior.
Yes.
Your life no longer belongs to you. It belongs to him.
Yes.
I gotta. Transforming word for you in your paradigm. Your money doesn't belong to you either.
Right.
It belongs to God.
Amen.
I was talking to a great man I know. He is a good Christian man. He does financial counseling. He's helped many people become financially secure. Some people he took from millions of dollars to debt and brought them to prosperity. Helped them turn things around. Did that for the state of California more than once. All with godly principles. And he was saying to me at Thanksgiving time, he said, you know, if we could just let the people of God understand that it's nothing is theirs.
Right.
Not their possessions, not their lives, nothing. We are all just stewards of what belongs to God.
Amen.
He's already bought us with a price.
Yes. Yes.
What a precious price, his own blood. He bought us. So we are merely stewards of his possession. He lets us have the cars. He lets us have the homes. He allows us to have the bank accounts. He allows us to give to the work of the Lord. He allows us to have the children. Our children aren't ours.
Amen.
He places them in our lives for us to train up in the way they should go, so when they are old, they will depart from it. Everything is God's.
Yes, it is.
Amen.
Yes.
Let's go to Romans 1:15. So as much as is in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath shewed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that, when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. Let's look at some nuggets from that text. First of all, our key verse, the title of this message today, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth.
Yes.
Amen.
I charge you not to be ashamed that you are a Christian. Do not be ashamed to tell people about the saving power of the blood of Jesus and the grace that can be had found. I don't want to be a Bible thumper. Man up. Woman up.
Praise
so
God.
What?
He may not like me.
Who cares?
Yes, amen.
I believe, though, the Holy Spirit can give you wisdom on how to communicate the gospel in a fashion to where they not only like you, but they love you because they know you love them. And you're talking about a God that wants to save their sorry souls from going to hell. Something in yesterday at the men's breakfast that as I was been writing the Christmas play in my head, I write things in my head before I put them on paper. I said, I'm very tempted to have a different ending. Usually, in every Christmas show, you have some crisis and some person that doesn't know the Lord, and through something or another, they accept Jesus and everybody rejoices, you know? And you tell the story of the Nativity. I said, but I'm just really tempted this year because of the state of our world and the state of the church.
All right,
amen. I'm really tempted to have a person reject Christ and go to hell.
All right,
now. On Christmas? That would be a horrible Christmas story. Well, it's a horrible story for millions of people who live it every day. They reject Christ and they go to hell.
Yes.
How foolish. We don't have to do anything. He did it all.
Yes, he did.
It doesn't matter what mistakes we have made. All we have to do is repent and ask him to help us. The word of God says, a willing heart is acceptable unto God. Yes. Though our sins were scarlet, like he will make us white as snow.
Hallelujah.
We don't have to do anything. He already did it.
Yes.
We just have to accept and be obedient and believe and walk out our faith.
Man, praise the Lord.
For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. You gotta have faith.
Amen.
You gotta have faith that God did what he said he would do and that he will do what he said he would do.
Amen.
You have to have a righteous fear of God as well.
Yes, yes.
You have to fear hell almost as much as you love God.
All right now.
You see, the devil has pulled a trick and the church has fallen for a hook, line, and sinker.
Amen.
You got pastors throughout the world that won't even mention hell in a sermon. Yes.
All right.
Because it will scare people away.
Well,
I'd rather scare people away once and have them come back and hear the truth than go there one day.
All right. Yes.
I don't want a church full of people that don't live righteous and holy before God.
Praise
God. That die thinking they're in good standing with God because they were hearers of the words only and not doers. And they had a form of godliness, but they denied the power thereof.
All right.
And when they perished, they were cast into the lake of fire.
My Lord Jesus.
I don't want to stand before God and say, I know you told me to tell them the truth of your word, but I didn't want to scare them away.
All right now.
Amen.
I want to teach the truth of God's word. Yes, there is a hell. Yes, there is a devil. But guess what? Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world.
Amen.
We used to sing that. Greater is he that is in me. Greater is he that is in me. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. The verse goes on to overcome our sin.
All right.
Because they, that which may be known, God is manifest in them, for God hath shown it unto them. God will make his ways clear if you're seeking to know them. He says his laws are written on the heart of man.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Where are we today? And I said we, I mean as a culture, as a nation, not as a church, not as this church, but as many of the churches in this nation. Where are we today?
Hallelujah.
For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. I want to tell you, we live in a generation that calls good evil and calls evil good.
Amen.
I don't have to tell you anymore. All you have to do is turn on the television set, listen to a radio commentator, listen to some of the pastors in the mega churches.
My Lord Jesus.
Yep.
God has shown it to them so that they are without excuse.
Praise God.
we have the truth in the Word of God.
Yes.
We need to preach it. We need to teach it. And we need to live it. Because that when the new God glorified Him not as God. Oh, how many people fall by this way. There are people that attend this very church that have loved ones that God has raised up from the dead miraculously.
All right.
More than one.
Yes.
And the raising of the dead wasn't enough to convince them to serve God. And the members don't even give God the credit anymore.
Hallelujah.
Oh, he must not have really been dead.
Hallelujah.
Well, dead is dead the last time I looked at it. I mean, you know, there's no brain activity, there's no heartbeat unless I'm drinking, there's no breath. Dead is dead is dead is dead.
Amen.
When the doctor says, time of death, closes the eyes, you're dead.
All right.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I've been in too many emergency rooms to know that dead is dead.
My Lord Jesus.
And when you lay your hands on somebody and you pray for them, they open up their eyes and they sit up, you know that God did a miracle.
Yeah.
I don't care if the family doesn't give God the glory, I'm going to give God the glory.
Yeah.
Because God did a miracle.
Yeah.
Why would they give Satan his glory by saying it wasn't really God, but the person wasn't really dead?
All right now.
Why is it when the person is laying there in a coma, and they say, we're turning the machine off, there's no brain activity, and you walk into the room, and you pray with them, and they get up out of that bed the next minute, then they say, oh, the doctors made a mistake, they weren't really in a coma. Why don't they want to glorify God when He heals them? Why don't they want to give God the glory and serve Him when they get up out of that bed?
Hallelujah.
Why do they want to go around making excuses and saying that God never did it? I know one thing. Sister Mary Lou had some miracles in her family, and she's giving God the glory all the time.
Amen.
Time after time after time, she's giving God the glory for that. Neither were they thankful.
My Lord Jesus.
They don't even thank God. God does a miracle in their life or in their loved ones. They don't even thank God. Oh, that wasn't God. It was a big black dog.
No, no. God is God.
I actually had somebody tell me that. God didn't really heal me. It was that big black dog that I saw in my vision in my coma. That dog brought me out of it. So I knew I needed to go buy a big black dog. That's foolishness. That's foolishness.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Why didn't they say, God healed me, He raised me up, I was dead, and now I'm alive. I was in a coma, I was in a bed, they said there was no hope, but the pastor, he came and he prayed, and the Spirit of God moved upon me in that room, and I sat up healed, and now I'm going to come to church every Sunday, I'm going to serve God with all of my heart, I'm going to let my shackles fall off, I'm going to be a living testimony of the goodness of God. Why? Because the scripture told us that they wouldn't be thankful.
Not
even thankful when God spares their very life.
All right.
I'm thankful. He spared my life. I died of an overdose in a crack house. He spared my life. I called on Jesus and He brought me back alive 24 minutes later. I am very grateful. I give God all the glory for that. I am grateful.
Amen.
I am grateful. I was poisoned with strychnine. I should have died. I was being made an example of, and I was supposed to be the fall guy, and they had poisoned me with such quantities of strychnine it didn't leave my body for 2 weeks, but I had a mama who was on her knees praying to Almighty God, and He saved my sorry old self.
Amen.
He made me a saint. Oh, but I wasn't very smart, was I? I kept on. This world we live in is a very powerful pull on people. I kept on, until finally one night I was driving drunk 65 miles an hour, and I went head on into a snowfield pole, and an angel of God showed up in the car and folded me under the steering wheel, so I walked away with not an injury. I give God glory. That was all God.
Yeah.
It was the only reason I'm here today, is because He was merciful when I was foolish. Let's give God the glory, folks.
Amen.
Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools.
Yeah. Right?
Happens over and over.
Man, result.
Over and over.
Yeah.
They save teeth from monkeys and they find out there's no proof of it.
Amen.
Amen.
I go on and on.
Hallelujah.
I charge you, remember who you are and what your calling is. Ye also, the call of Jesus Christ.
Yes,
you're the call of Jesus. 1 John 3:1, behold the manner of love the Father bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons and the daughters of God. Therefore, the world knew us not, because it knew him not.
Amen.
1 Peter 2:9, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should shew forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light.
Praise the Lord.
Matthew 5:13-16, ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is then thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under a foot of men.
Yes, Lord.
Ye are the light of the world, a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hid.
Yes.
Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Mark 16:15, and he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature.
Yes, amen.
That was not just to the apostles, that's to the church.
Amen.
That's to every one of us.
Yes.
To go and preach the gospel to every creature. Find a way, get in his presence, get the pattern down, let the Holy Spirit give you the process. Let us not forget the theme for this entire year.
Praise God, praise God.
Let's say it together. If my people,
which
are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. Hallelujah. It's not over for America. Not as long as you and I will do this. It's not over for the church. As long as there are people in the church that will do this. Let us stand. Thank you, Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for sending Jesus. Thank you for sending us your word. Thank you for sending us your Holy Spirit. Thank you that you came and dwelt among us. Thank you that you laid down your life after living in perfect way. Thank you that you paid the price so that we don't have to pay. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, the blood of Jesus.
desire to grow closer to you, Lord. You know the desire to go to the next realm of service, Lord. Lord, we just, I just pray right now, Lord, and I agree with them, that you are the God Almighty who says, yes, I want to prosper you. Yes, I want to